Hello, everybody. I'm Jerry Romig, and welcome to Airport Alive, a show all about your Louis Armstrong New Orleans International Airport. We've got a great show for you, and we're going to go right into it. Whenever trouble rears its head at the airport, it's usually the Emergency Operations Center, or the EOC, that springs into action first. Airport Deputy Director and Chief of Operations Walter Krygowski talked with us recently about the EOC's role during airport emergencies and how they use state-of-the-art technology to stay trained and ready. Let's take a look.
Walter, the first thing, of course, that you notice when you step into the EOC, the Emergency Operations Center, is the technology here. Tell us about it.
Well, technology is of critical importance in our Emergency Operations Center because as we look at and evaluate the potential situation or emergency incident, we can pull up with our state-of-the-art technology that we have here, any of the cameras that we have throughout the terminal building, so we can get that real-time video and see what's going on and properly deploy those resources. We also, if we have a hurricane or pending storm, we can pull up national news, we can pull up weather information, as well as flight track information, so that we can have a holistic approach on how we address and resolve any kind of situations that may arise.
What determines who's present in case of an emergency? Is it the type of emergency, where the emergency happens, like airfield versus terminal? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, depending on the situation, it could be an emergency situation on our airfield where we would bring in those key personnel that will help take care of that emergency situation, because our optimum goal is to provide for the safety of our traveling passengers as well as all the users of our facility. So we bring the key personnel in to make the decisions and render that decisions out into the field so we can deploy the appropriate resources to take care of that emergency situation. Or in the event of big event such as the Super Bowl, we would have the key personnel so that we would monitor the terminal activities to make sure that we can properly address and identify any kind of situation and deploy those key personnel to take and resolve that incident.
Do you ever have cause to bring in parish law enforcement, parish security from Jefferson Parish, Orleans Parish, in case of an emergency, if there's a major catastrophe?
In the event of a major catastrophe, certainly our outreach efforts and the use of this facility will be quite broad. We'll bring in local officials from the parishes, from the city of New Orleans. We'll bring in state officials, and as appropriate and applicable, we'll also bring in federal officials. Depending on the type of emergency, if it involves something with an aircraft, we would also bring in the key personnel from that particular air carrier so that we can work collectively to address that situation.
For our listeners, and our viewers rather, if there's an emergency at the airport and they happen to notice it first, do they call 911 like we do on outside of the airport, or is there another number?
No, we encourage people who are in the terminal to pick up one of our courtesy phones. They're a white phone that we have strategically located both on the ticketing lobby, the baggage claim, and in the concourses. If you pick up that phone and dial 2700, you go into our own dispatch center, which is called AVCOM, or Aviation Communication Center. In this way, unlike calling 911, they can deploy the resources and identify where you are in the facility so that we can swiftly react and provide whatever is needed to handle that situation.
When you pick the phone up, is there something that guides you to call the 2700 number? Do you get a prompt, I guess is what I'm asking?
There's clear signage that's available right next to the courtesy phones and tells you to dial the 2700. For those who have proclivities to use cell phones, we also allow calls to come in on to our Aviation Communications Center by dialing 504-464-2700.
I noticed when I was walking around the airport that there are defibrillators strategically placed everywhere. Tell us, is that something new?
We make sure that we provide the best environment for people who are traveling or using our facility. So we do have those defibrillators placed throughout the whole terminal environment and on our concourses. So if we have a medical emergency, someone can go to the unit, activate the unit, and be able to provide whatever assistance is necessary by using the defibrillator. It also sends an audible alarm to our Aviation Communications Center so they also can deploy the emergency response units that would be necessary.
I know that there are some things that you have to do to prepare on a regular basis. Tell us a little bit about the training that goes into preparing for these emergencies.
Well, certainly our staff is continuously training. It's important that we stay abreast of upcoming threats or possible ways that we can improve the delivery of emergency services. So staff is continuously training. In addition, we have annual training where we ask and invite other participants and stakeholders such as local, state, and federal officials to come in and actively work various scenarios. This year, we're kind of pleased that we have what's called a triannual exercise. And that is sort of a real life scenario situation where we actually deploy personnel and actually simulate an emergency event. It allows us then to cooperate with those folks from the outside agencies and our mutual aid providers so they get to know the airport better and be able to deploy those resources in an effective manner to help us resolve any kind of situation or emergency that could happen here at the airport. Because of the unique environment that we're in, it could range anything from natural disasters and making sure that we can get this facility up and running after a storm maybe has come through, all the way to just making sure that we have a proper flow of passengers and that we're providing that safe environment for the passengers that are going out on various aircraft. So it allows us to have that one-on-one interaction to get to know the key stakeholders and have them understand and get to know the airport officials so that we have seamless communication in responding to any potential emergency that could arise.
And now I know that you do the main exercise, that major exercise, every 3 years, did you say?
Yes.
But you do some tabletop exercises once a year or so, annually. What's the difference?
Well, the differences are that in our annual tabletop exercise, you don't get that real life experience. It's pretty much scripted. It's where you run through the scenarios and address those what if situations. However, when we do the major exercise every 3 years, it is that real life experience where folks don't necessarily know all the fact patterns and they have to critically think and respond to various interjects that come in. So that real life simulation is certainly provides broader based training for all the personnel that come into our environment that need to provide that assistance.
Are there special preparations that you go through each year just because of this hurricane season?
Yes, we have a comprehensive hurricane preparedness plan, and it outlines all the responsibilities that the airport has. The ultimate goal of the plan is to be able to stay here and keep the airport functioning and active as long as possible until the storm force winds do come into our environment and stop that commercial air service. And then it allows us and identifies the measures then steps that we need to take to make sure that we reactivate this airport at the soonest possible time after the hurricane passes.
During hurricanes, is the airport used as a shelter?
No, the airport facility itself is not a public shelter, and we do not encourage any folks to come here thinking that they can shelter at our facility. Unfortunately, we will have to turn them away.
We'll be right back with more Airport Alive.
Luggage, cell phones, and even a trophy. These are some of the hundreds of items that our passengers have left behind at Armstrong International Airport. If you lose an item when traveling through MSY, it may be in one of the lost and found departments maintained by your airline, TSA, or airport customer service. All lost items given to airport customer service are entered into our new online inventory system and then posted on the airport website for an easy search. Did you lose a personal item during your travels at Armstrong International Airport? If so, check out Lost and Found at flymsy.com. If we have it, we want to arrange a happy reunion with you and your belongings.
If you've spent any time at the airport lately, you've surely noticed our customer service representatives and our ambassadors. They're decked out in burgundy jackets and vests stationed throughout the airport. They're hardworking greeters, and they're part of Armstrong International's renewed focus on providing the best customer service. Our cameras recently caught up with Airport Deputy Director and Customer Service Officer Michelle Wilcut. She says the effort is paying off in positive feedback, and she lets you know how you can volunteer to be a customer service ambassador.
Now, for folks who are visiting the airport lately, there has been a real emphasis on customer service with a lot of new amenities. Tell us a little bit about that.
Actually, we've done some really great things over the past 2 or 3 years. We've instituted a customer service program. We now have paid staff who actually are out in the ticket lobbies, greeting customers, making sure they're having a good day. We have an ambassador program where if somebody wants to volunteer to spend some time at the airport, they can actually come out here and volunteer with us and greet guests, help guests through baggage claim, help them get to wherever they may be trying to go, find restrooms, and just find the amenities that are around the facility.
To be an ambassador, that's a volunteer program, right?
That is correct.
What are the requirements to become an ambassador here at the airport?
Actually, just be willing to come out here and volunteer your time. We will provide you with free parking. You can register on our website, and we offer training programs as we're bringing people on, provide you with a vest, and you actually come out here and you get to meet a lot of really great people. We really tend to beef up the ambassador staff and the regular customer service staff during large events, just like when Essence just broke up. We had extra ambassadors and customer service staff on hand to make sure everybody got through the lines at the ticket counters and through the checkpoints quickly.
Now, there's been a real surge in activity out here, of course, lately. A lot of new concessions have been opening up. I would imagine that customer service was a big part of the training to get these new concessions going.
Absolutely. Hudson Group, who is the master concessionaire for our news and gift, and Delaware North Companies, who does our food and beverage, they both have huge customer service programs nationwide. There's a real emphasis on that, and we continue to push. And, you know, if you're coming out here, even if you're not in a customer service aspect of a job here, if you're somebody who does baggage handling, every employee that has a badge at this airport has to go through a small customer service module just to know what to look for. If you see somebody walking through that just looks like they're lost or needs some extra help, we've really tried to train everybody to go out of your way to help those people.
So the Aviation Board actually monitors the level of customer service work out here at the airport.
We do to a certain extent with that small module. So you know, we may not have direct control over a lot of things. You know, we don't hire most of the employees here, but we do have a little bit of impact when we're issuing them badges. We make them go through a training module, and we also instituted a secret shopper program for our food and beverage and our news and gift retailers. So we hired a group to come in here, and actually they secret shop each and every store throughout the entire terminal once a month. So we really get a good feedback, and it's coming from a third party. So we're getting a real true reading of what it's like to be a guest here in our facility.
Michelle, if someone has a compliment or a complaint about the customer service treatment they received here at the airport, how do they get that to you guys?
Actually, if they have a concern about anything, they can email us via our website, flymsy.com. If you click on Contact Us, there's all of our phone numbers, as well as a link for emails, and it's customer.service@flymsy.com. And actually, that email account is monitored by myself and several other staff members, but we're required to respond within 72 hours. We respond to all questions, comments, good, bad, or indifferent that come into that account. And really, it gives us a mechanism to see things that might be good and things that might need some improving. So we've come up with some really good ideas out of that account, and it helps us to know if we're doing a good job or if we've, instituted something that people really aren't liking.
Well, the airport is definitely looking up. Michelle, as always, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you once again for being with us.
Thank you.
We'll be right back with more Airport Alive.
Come to Louisiana and pick your passion.
An airport's success is measured by how many people board flights each day. There's a lot of competition between airports for flights and passengers, and developing new service is a full-time job. Jeff Sigmon, air service manager for our airport, talked with us recently about that competition. He also reports on new service coming to Armstrong International and how our airport is bucking a national trend for an airport our size. Let's take a look.
Welcome back to Airport Alive. Joining us today on the show is Air Service and Cargo Development Manager, Mr. Jeff Sigmon. Jeff, welcome back to Airport Alive.
Thanks, Phil. Glad to be back.
I understand that we've got new service coming to New Orleans International Airport. Tell us all about it.
So on November 3rd, Southwest is going to start their nonstop to Austin, Texas. It's going to be a daily flight on a Boeing 737 aircraft with 137 seat capacity.
One flight a day?
One flight per day, seven times a week.
Why is this big news? Why Austin? What makes Austin so attractive?
Believe it or not, Austin has been one of the most requested cities from New Orleans for many years, and demand's been increasing since that time, and this is a reaction to that increase in demand.
I know that Austin has a big music scene, very much like New Orleans. Outside of the music scene, are there other things that make Austin an attractive place for New Orleanians?
Yeah, so besides the music and tourism, there's a software and digital industry that's been growing here as well as in Austin, so they have that relationship together.
Do you think it's because of our rebuilding? Do you think it's because of tourism?
I think it's because the city's economy and tourism is booming. And this is a reaction to that.
Jeff, I know that it's competition always for air service for more seats. And I know that you guys attend some events every year that put you in front of airline representatives where you can make your pitch. Can you tell us a little bit about who these organizations are and what's the process like?
Sure. So there's 849 airports with scheduled service out there right now that we're actually competing with for air service. There's only so many few airplanes and so many airlines. But there are organizations such as ACI, which stands for Airport Councils International. It's a trade organization that we're a member of. And they give us an opportunity to get face-to-face with some of the planners. And we can give them our business case and market updates and network with them. And as well, we visit an airline headquarters, and also they come and visit us from time to time where we can give them updates and business cases that they might not know otherwise.
You would think that tourism is the big selling point here, but surprise me, what else do you use to pitch New Orleans as the place to come to?
Tourism is the big one, but there are also a growing business community. Conventions are growing, cruises are doing phenomenal. All that attributes to demand, and demand is what airlines want to see.
Now, Jeff, if somebody wanted to find out about new service, new nonstop service, what's the quickest way for them to do that? How do they do that?
They can go to our website, flymsy.com, and click on airline info, and they can have a direct link to the website and other contact information right there in front of them.
Well, Jeff, as always, it's a pleasure having you on the show. We look forward to more reports on increased air service in the future. Thank you for joining us. We'll be right back after these messages.
Are you a fan of Louis Armstrong New Orleans International Airport? If so, we want to hear from you. You can like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, or send us a comment on our contact page on the airport website, flymsy.com. Tell us about your latest airport experience at MSY and what you enjoy the most or the least. We welcome your comments and suggestions because what you have to say is important to us. So stay in touch, be a fan, like us, follow us, and watch us.
And finally, on today's show, not only are we getting new air service at Armstrong International, we're getting new airplanes, too. We were recently chosen as the airport to debut the inaugural arrival of a new regional jet that will bring more passengers to Armstrong International. American Airlines made it happen, and our cameras were there to catch it all.
Prior to the plane's arrival, representatives from the City of New Orleans, the airport, and American Airlines conducted a special ribbon-cutting ceremony to commemorate the event. Upon arrival, the new regional aircraft was greeted with a water cannon salute, and disembarking passengers were greeted by Armstrong International, customer service representatives, and ambassadors with Mardi Gras beads and refreshments. As the passengers left the plane, we spoke with Amy Quirk, economic advisor to the mayor of New Orleans, about the significance of this new aircraft debut at our airport.
Well, over the last 3 years, we've been very focused on making our airport as competitive as possible so that airlines will want to make investments that will bring more passengers and promote connectivity to our city. More passengers means more jobs, more revenue at this airport, more people in our hotels, more people in our restaurants, more people here doing business. And so today's announcement is proof of airlines showing confidence in our market and wanting to bring bigger aircraft, their newest, best aircraft, to our city. It'll bring 250 passengers, new passengers, every week. And that means business for our city. We've really tuned the model, retooled our model at the airport to make it more focused on competitiveness, to bring our cost to the airlines down so that they would be more comfortable in bringing more flights here, and that's paying off. Beyond that, what we see what's going on in the city is business is booming. We've got retail investments going on across the city, new businesses coming. Last year we announced that GE was coming to our city. It's just one of many exciting examples of what's going on in the city.
Airport Director of Aviation, Iftikhar Ahmad, gave us his thoughts on this important decision by American Airlines.
I think that New Orleans is on an upswing. This great city is coming back much stronger, with more vigor than even before Katrina. Wall Street Journal covered an article about a month ago in which they showed that all these airports, our colleagues, are losing service about 26%, and that we had picked up about 10% up. That was the only airport in the United States. And it's announcements like these that get us there. And what this means to us is that the airlines are basically showing their faith in the progress that we're making, and they're backing it up with seats. They believe more business is going to take place in New Orleans, more tourism will take place in New Orleans, and so they're trying to get ahead of it. They're upgauging their aircrafts, and they're bringing in more service. This is right at the heel of, you know, the announcement with Key West, the announcement with that we're going to have nonstop to Austin, or the announcement that we're going to now start flying to Cancun from here. And I think all of these announcements together are putting us on this direction in that place that Wall Street was talking about. We are working very closely with all our partners, especially with the board and us. We're working very closely with Mayor Landrieu, and we are working together and we're trying to see, you know, trying to set stage for this world-class airport that we're gonna build by May 2018, but a world-class airport needs world-class service and world-class air service, and there are strategies that we're talking about, including international service to Europe and Latin America. And these type of routes are important to developing business in our city, and it has this compounding effect in terms of good growth and quality of life for our community, and that's why we're so focused on it. And because we all have the same goal with the city, so it just binds us together, and it's given us some really great results. US Air is wanting to move from Concourse B to come here, whereas they're consolidating for Concourse C. So all the business that was taking place under US Air in Concourse B will then take place in Concourse C. And they're going to merge here in the same area. But in terms of air service, where there will be many, many airports, that will either lose their hub or air service because one or the two are going to cut service because maybe US Air and American were going to the same nonstop from that airport. Our lines don't entangle. US Air and American are providing different service. So I think when they merge, we will not only keep our service, we're hopeful that they would increase their presence here in this concourse and in this airport and in this city.
Dale Morris, American Airlines Regional Vice President for Government Affairs, talked about the new jet and the new livery and look of American Airlines.
It's a beautiful aircraft. It's a larger regional jet that offers three-class service. You have 12 first-class seats, 20 of our main cabin extra seats, which gives you about 6 inches of more pitch, and then 44 main cabin seats. It's a very smooth ride and a very comfortable aircraft. Initially, we're operating in three markets today. We're in New Orleans being one of our flagship destinations today, also Pittsburgh, and we're also flying to Albuquerque. And we're taking delivery of these aircraft as they become available, and we'll get them as soon as they're available from Republic, who is doing the flying for us. We looked at our numbers and we looked at the opportunities here in New Orleans, and there's been tremendous growth in New Orleans. As you can see, the airport has developed, and which is a good thing. We love what we see happening here at the airport. And also, Mayor Landrieu has done a phenomenal job in tourism and economic development. So all those factors weighed into our decision to bring the newer three-class service, bigger RJs, here to New Orleans. This plane is actually painted that in the new livery. We have a new livery that we introduced a couple months ago, and our planes are actually being configured to those color schemes. Ones that are new planes that we're taking delivery of are coming out of the factory with the new color scheme. American is becoming the new American Airlines. We're merging with US Air in the process of merging, waiting for a DOJ approval. But we're also merging with them, and you're going to see that's the first and foremost issue, is to get merged and then take care of our customers and then go from there.
Stephen Courtois, the American Airlines Airport General Manager, commented on the impact of this exciting event.
What this means for American Airlines is a capacity increase of 250 plus seats a week. That's 1,000 new faces a month into our city. That represents economic growth. And it's always good for the city to have that.
Hunter Goodson, American Airlines Senior Analyst Product Design Onboard Products, who designed the interior of the aircraft, was on hand to give us more details about the new jet.
We started on this project back in November, and basically nose to tail, everything on the inside of the plane, our team had a hand in. This is the largest aircraft in the American Eagle fleet. It's the first to offer our main cabin extra product, which is going to offer our customers more choices and more comfort throughout the cabin. So the cabin layout is 12 first class seats, 20 main cabin extra seats, and then 44 main cabin seats. So other exciting features about this aircraft, it's the first regional jet in the American Eagle fleet to offer full-size overhead bins. It's going to be really important for customers because it enables them to actually bring their full-size rollerboards on board versus having to gate check it when they come to the aircraft. So that's really exciting. Additionally, this is going to be the first American Eagle aircraft to offer Wi-Fi. And the cabin design elements of the aircraft are much inspired by our new mainline fleet. So a lot of the colors and the trims and finishes you're going to see fleet-wide throughout the American Airlines mainline fleet. So the brand transition between regional and mainline is going to be much more seamless than it is today.
Well, that's our show. Thanks for watching this edition of Airport Alive. You can also view Airport Alive or get airport information, including flight schedules, by visiting our website at flymsy.com or stay in touch with us on Facebook and Twitter. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time on Airport Alive. Fly, 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 fly.